Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you for joining our live webinar, where today we'll be covering two presentations, Diagnostic Approach in COVID-19, followed by the Clinical Challenges and Management of COVID-19. My name is Dr. Vineet Nair, and I will be a moderator for today's event. Today's webinar is brought to you by Suburban Diagnostics in conjunction with Horiba Medical. I would like to remind everyone that today's webinar is interactive, and we encourage you to participate by submitting as many questions as you want at any time you want during the presentation. To submit a question, simply type the question into the chat box to your right and click send. At the end of the presentation, we will be having a Q&A session and will answer as many questions as time permits. If you have any trouble seeing or hearing the presentation, please use the chat box to let us know that you're experiencing a problem. Please note, with this webinar, we will be giving certificates of attendance. All those who complete the webinars and wish to be provided with certificates must fill a form, which we will provide you at the end of the webinars. This form only asks you for your email as well as your name and title as you want it to appear on the certificate. Please remember, only those who fill out the form will be provided the certificate. I would now like to introduce our first speaker, Dr. Anupa Dixit, who will be speaking on the topic, Diagnostic Approach to COVID-19. Dr. Anupa is the Laboratory Director of Suburban Diagnostics and has held the post for over 16 years. She was responsible for obtaining the much coveted dual accreditations from NABL and the College of American Pathologists for Suburban Diagnostics, and is also the leading force behind COVID-19 testing at Suburban Diagnostics since March of 2020. A dynamic and sought-after speaker at conferences and CMEs, she is known for her bright and humor-filled presentations. Without any further ado, let me hand over the reins of this webinar over to Dr. Anupa. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Vineet. So a very good evening to all of you. First and foremost, I would like to thank Dr. Vasant Nagwekar for sharing the platform as a co-speaker, Team Horiba for providing us the platform to connect with all of you, and finally, the team back at Suburban Diagnostics for continuous support, guidance, and in organizing this series of Knowledge Spree. Now, as we all know, coronavirus disease 2019 is an emerging global pandemic caused by severe acute respiratory syndrome, coronavirus 2, which is also known as SARS-CoV-2. As the number of individuals infected with COVID-19 continues to rise globally, it is clear that the clinical laboratory will play a crucial role in the crisis, contributing to patient screening, diagnosis, monitoring, as well as epidemiologic surveillance. As of today, worldwide, we have around more than 3.5 million cases of COVID-19, which have been reported in around 210 countries and resulting in more than 250,000 deaths. Now, I'm sure we all are enriched with the information on SARS-CoV-19 through various sources, but just to revise few facts, SARS-CoV-2 virus belongs to a beta coronavirus order, which in turn belongs to family Coronaviridae and order Neroviridae. Now, the name coronavirus comes from the Latin word corona, which means crown, and typically refers to the characteristic bulbous surface projections, creating an image which is very similar to the solar halo. Coronavirus morphologically are minute in size. It roughly measures around 100 nanometers in diameter and contain a single-stranded RNA as nuclear material. The genome is the longest and measures around 30 kb in length. The subgroup of coronavirus family are alpha, beta, gamma, and delta coronavirus. The genome has 96% nucleotide identity to the beta coronavirus. Now, as we see in the picture, the virus typically is covered by a bilipid layer with presence of certain structural proteins named as envelope nucleoprotein E, spike protein S, and membrane glycoprotein M, which plays a very crucial role when it comes to the diagnosis of coronavirus. It is very important to know that the virus is mainly transmitted through droplets. Now, these droplets are generated when an infected person either sneezes, coughs, or exhales. These droplets are too heavy to stay or hang in the air and quickly falls on the surface or floor. People can become infected by touching these objects and surfaces. and then henceforth touching their eyes, nose and mouth, they become infected. As per the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, which is CDC, symptoms may typically appear between 2 and 14 days of exposure to the virus. Patients primarily have cough and shortness of breath, or at least two of the other symptoms, which could be the chills, myalgia, headache, sore throat, loss of taste or smell, or fever. Indian Council of Medical Research, known as ICMR, has released testing strategy and has laid guidelines for testing in the hotspots and also for the rest of the country. As per ICMR, real-time reverse transcription, PCR, and the point-of-care molecular diagnostic assays are recommended for diagnosis of individuals under the following category. For the entire country, all the symptomatic individuals who have undertaken international travel in the last 14 days, all symptomatic contacts of laboratory confirmed cases, all symptomatic healthcare workers, all patients with severe acute respiratory illness, and asymptomatic direct or high-risk contact of a lab-confirmed case within a period of 5 days to 14 days are the right candidate for doing or undergoing a testing. Also for the hotspot, they have released guidelines where a symptomatic patient who has influenza-like illness can undergo testing. This slide talks majorly about the algorithm which is provided by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare along with ICMR for hotspot diagnosis. Now in this, any symptomatic patient with influenza-like illness for a duration which is less than 7 days need to be tested via RT-PCR test. And for the ones who are symptomatic for more than 7 days, they need to be diagnosed through rapid antibody test. Although important, it is very important to know that the private laboratories are still not given any permission to start antibody testing, whereas RT-PCR can be performed by ICMR-approved NABL RNA testing laboratories. So as per the ICMR advisory for rapid antibody test in hotspots, the gold standard still remains the RT-PCR. The rapid antibody test cannot replace as a test for diagnosis. And the antibody test is a supplementary tool to assess the prevalence of the disease within a specified period or a perimeter. And its utility is majorly beyond 7 days of symptoms. And the utility is still getting involved. And it is very useful for the epidemiology surveillance and the study purpose. That's the limit which has been kept for this. Now, coming to a very important aspect, which is understanding the time span of the disease. So in order to decide which test to be performed and at what period of disease cycle, it is extremely important to understand the timestamp of the virus life cycle. It is noteworthy that the presence of RNA in specimen does not always correlate with the viral transmissibility, which means that RNA RT-PCR can remain positive 6 to 8 days after loss of infectivity, as seen in the lowermost line graph, which depicts the days in the x-axis, the incubation period, that is the time between the exposure and the onset of symptom, ranges between 2 days and 14 days, with a median of 5 days. Now, assuming the onset of symptom happens at 0 days, it is important to note that the median virus shedding is 12 days, but it can be seen 2 days before the onset of symptom, or it can go on till 24 days of symptom onset. It is extremely important to understand that viral RNA from stool remains detectable for at least 6 to 10 days after negative conversion in respiratory swabs, whereas serum IgM starts rising from 5 to 10 days of the onset of the symptom, peaks around 21 days, and starts declining by more than 35 days. Whereas serum IgG starts rising between 12 days and 14 days, and peaks around 29 days, and very little is known about the decline of IgG so far. Disease life cycle is another aspect which has been covered by RCPA. RCPA's Royal College of Pathologists for Australasia, which has recently released position report, position statement on the disease life cycle, wherein some analysis was conducted on the role and level of antibodies in diagnosis of condition during different time periods. As you can see, the x-axis shows the number of days, whereas the y-axis talks about the viral titer. The most important outcome of this analysis was the antibody testing, if done in the early phase of the disease cycle, might miss the patient, and that is not very acceptable. And that's the time when your RNA-PCR starts rising. Elderly or immunocompromised may never develop antibodies. Also, to keep a note that COVID-19 positive patients, the maximum viral shedding happens during or on just before the onset of the symptom. So these are the few deductions which were very, very important to understand how the treatment or the diagnosis protocol need to be taken care of. The analysis outcome of RCPA was corroborated by another Chinese study, which was conducted on RT-PCR method, wherein the graph was plotted between the viral load, y-axis, and the duration of the illness, which is mentioned in the x-axis in the form of days. The viral load is measured in the form of CT value. The CT value is threshold cycle value, which means when the CT value is low, the viral load is always on the higher side. It's inversely proportional to the viral load. As you can see in this graph, the thick line shows the trend in the viral load. The conclusion of the study was the viral load is highest around the onset of the symptom and tapers down and fades away roughly around 21 days of illness. Now, we have spoken about which test to be conducted at what period of the disease, but it's equally important to understand what sample need to be collected. So for RT-PCR, respiratory samples are the most recommended ones. In an ambulatory patient, nasopharyngeal and oropharyngeal swabs are the recommended ones. Whereas in lower respiratory specimens, non-induced sputum, endotracheal aspirate, or bronchoalveolar lavage are recommended in patients with more severe respiratory disease. It is important to note that the sample-wise positivity rate matters a lot in the interpretation of the report. Finally, note that nasopharyngeal samples show 37% chance of being false negative as compared to 7% chance seen with bronchoalveolar lavage samples. Lower respiratory tract sample like non-induced sputum could be a good source to pick up positivity. It is important also to note that oropharyngeal samples have 68% chances of missing the positivity, in spite of following the correct protocol of collecting the swab. So in a case of negative RT-PCR report and with a strong clinical suspect, a repeat with upper and lower respiratory sample is very, very recommended. Kindly keep in mind, extremely low positivity is also seen in feces, blood, and urine, and they are almost not recommended for testing. The pandemic always requires a set of three basic methodologies for testing or diagnosis. One is the gold standard. The other one usually is the antigen detection test, and which is supplemented by antibody test as well. Such triad of testing would ensure better detection rate so that none of the cases get missed. RT-PCR, as we discussed earlier, is still the gold standard and the test of choice. Antigen detection test detects the presence of viral proteins but shows false positivity. Now, the reason of false positivity could be the cross-reactivity with other coronavirus disease. So with lack of sensitivity and challenge in standardization of the kit, WHO does not currently recommend the use of antigen detection rapid diagnostic test for patient care. Although research into their performance and potential diagnostic utility is still getting evaluated and is highly recommended and encouraged. Now, WHO also recommends RT-PCR test as gold standard, which we know by now. It also recommends use of at least two different targets on the genome, for which one has to be specific for COVID-19. Keep in mind, the analytic sensitivity of the kit is extremely crucial because it might vary from 10 to 100 copies per run. So also that one or more negative results do not rule out the possibility of virus infection. So if you get a negative report from one test versus second report, which is coming positive, there are numerous factors which have to be kept in mind, which we will discuss in subsequent slides. Not all RT-PCR kits are the same. Every PCR kit has different analytic sensitivity, as mentioned, and also different target genes. Where in the E gene is the screening gene for beta coronavirus family. N gene, S gene, RDRP genes are specific for SARS-CoV-2 virus. So this is how the RT-PCR tests are formulated with different combinations, keeping in mind that one of the target genes is a confirmatory gene. While interpreting the report, it's important to keep in mind the reasons for false positivity and false negativity. In our day-to-day practice, I come across a lot of queries regarding the true positive nature, false positive reasons, and the reasons for false negativity of the report. And which is why I thought I should discuss this during this presentation. Now, the reasons for false positivity is very unlikely. It's very important to note that RT-PCR tests are highly specific. So giving a report of RT-PCR false positive is very, very unlikely. Although false negativity has a lot of reasons which need to be kept in mind, it could be the pre-analytic reason or analytic causes. Pre-analytic reasons could be depending on the type of sample which we just discussed. It has to be kept in mind, like oropharyngeal samples collected alone might have a 68% chance of giving a false negative report. Inadequate sampling. If the sample is not collected properly and the swabs are not touching the right area, the report might come false negative. A sample which is collected too early in the disease phase or too late in the disease phase where the viral load is too less can give a false negative report. Samples also collected well but not handled well. Shipping is not done well, which means the temperature of transportation is not adequate, can also lead to problems. PCR inhibition is a very characteristic reason for giving a false negative in a specific sample. Also keep in mind the analytic sensitivity of the kit used. This we have also seen in our practice where a kit probably might miss out a weak positive report if we use a particular kit. So these are a lot of other factors which we need to keep in mind when we report or interpret a COVID-19 report. So there could be reasons where validated assays are not used. So these are all have to be kept in mind before we interpret. But if a negative result is obtained from a patient with a very high index of suspicion for COVID-19 virus, particularly when only upper respiratory tract samples are collected, additional samples, including that from the lower respiratory tract, if possible, should be collected and tested. This is extremely important to note so that we don't miss out on any positive case. There are a lot of queries floating around regarding the interpretation of consecutive reports. And I get a lot of calls regarding the interpretation. First report is negative, second positive. How do we interpret? So keeping these queries in mind, if you have first sample which is negative and the second sample comes positive, please factor in the time gap between the two samples. If the time gap between two samples is more than 5 days, there is a strong possibility the patient might be infected in the interim. Now, in our recent studies, which I have seen, or recent cases, we have seen the incubation period narrowing down to 2 days. So we don't have to wait for 5 days also. Within 2 days, the second report starts coming as positive. First sample is positive and the second sample negative. How do we interpret this report? In this case, always keep in mind the viral load shows a decreasing trend. or it has reduced to a level where it has not been able to get picked up by the RT-PCR kit, or else the patient is on his way of recovery. These two options have to be kept in mind. Also keep in mind, the second report could be a false negative for the reasons that we have enumerated earlier. Getting two positive consecutive samples, take that patient to be confirmed and the one having ongoing SARS-CoV-2 infection. Whereas if you get two negative results with a previously positive report, kindly assume the patient has recovered. This falls majorly as a discharge criteria for admission patient, where apart from the clinical improvement, two negative reports within a gap of more than 24 hours is the one which is looked for to discharge a patient. And also, please keep in mind to try to collect the sample as close as possible to the symptom onset. Now, at Suburban Diagnostics, since 24th March onwards, we have tested around 25,000 COVID patients at our molecular department. And it has given us immense learning, where we have realized that it requires immense planning and the resource planning as well for the same. Primary, first and foremost, is the staff safety, for which we created a task force. We released elaborate guidelines, especially related to the samples which are not COVID as well. Elaborate standard operating procedures were devised, and we had to devise it for the sample collection, packaging, transportation, how to don and doff PPE, and the sanitization protocols. All those were set in place, training was conducted. And then coming to the lab, we ensure that the kits are adequate. We tried multiple kits so far. We have enormous experience in, we can share that with all of you. And then enabling the quality checks in place, following the ICMR and the local authority compliances, where the prescription has to be adequately be there, the test request form filling, the valid identity proof with correct address. And there are other parameters which are extremely important to cover the entire aspect of COVID testing. We also got extra automation in the form of extraction unit and thermocycler to maintain the tag, which is very, very crucial. So it's an enormous experience, and the journey is still on COVID testing. So the take home message from my side would be, real-time reverse transcription PCR is currently the gold standard for diagnosing suspected cases of COVID-19. Keep in mind, the virus shedding is highest on or just before the onset of symptoms. So that's the right time to get a person tested for COVID-19. Recollect and test upper respiratory samples in patients with negative RT-PCR. And if you have a strong suspicion, please do the retest. Always factor in the limitation of sample type, clinical stage during sample collection, and the interpretation of report. Serology rapid tests do not have a role to play in acute diagnosis currently, and they are meant currently only for surveillance purpose or epidemiology purpose, and is restricted only to government authorities use currently. So this is from my side. I would like to thank Dr. Sanjay Arora, Dr. Amar Das Gupta, and my very close molecular department team for all the inputs, and Dr. Vineet for helping me in preparing the presentation. Thank you so much, all of you.
Thank you, ma'am, for that lovely and lucid presentation. Let me remind the audience that we will be answering your questions for both sessions together at the end. For those attendees who came in late, let me reiterate that with this webinar, we will be giving certificates of attendance. All those who complete the webinars and wish to be provided with the certificate must fill a form which we will provide to you at the end of the webinar. This form only asks for your email as well as your name and title as you want it to appear on the certificate. Let me repeat again, only those who fill out the form will be provided the certificate. Let me now introduce our second speaker, Dr. Vasant Nagvekar, who will be enlightening us on the clinical challenges in the management of COVID-19. Dr. Nagvekar is an eminent and renowned internal medicine and infectious disease specialist with over 25 years of experience in Parel, Mumbai. An eminent speaker and author of multiple publications, he is at present the head of the Infectious Diseases Department at Global Hospital and visiting consultant at Leelavati Hospital and Research Center. Over to you, sir.
Thanks, Dr. Mini. And at the outset, I would like to thank Dr. Sanjay Arora and Dr. Anupa for giving me this opportunity. I think Dr. Anupa has elaborated very nicely and lucidly about what all tests required to be done, when it is to be done, what are the false positives, false negatives. And I think it's very, very clear that what is required from a testing point of view, lab diagnosis point of view, from COVID-19. So I think let's come to the clinical challenges, and basically I'm going to take you through the management of COVID-19. And my first slide itself tells you that there are four stages. In fact, I would say predominantly three stages. I'll elaborate more as I keep discussing this. So the incubation period usually is around 1 to 14 days. And what we have found out is majority of the patients, usually more than 90% of them, would develop symptoms by between maximum by 5.4 days. So this is the incubation period. That means if I come across any person who is COVID-19 positive and accidentally if I'm in a close contact with that person, then I will be most likely developing symptoms anywhere from 1 to 14 days, but usually the average time would be around 5 days, that is seen in majority of the cases. And very important is, after this, once you start getting the symptoms, that is the prodromal symptoms, that is fever, cough, sore throat, myalgia, very important is that apart from respiratory tract complaints, diarrhea, vomiting, abdominal, GI complaints form around 16% of the people will only manifest with GI complaints. And the rest, around 40% of them, 30 to 40% would have respiratory tract plus GI complaints. Okay, so that is the thing. So GI complaints cannot be overlooked in the pandemic era of COVID-19. So that's very, very important. We have seen other clinical presentations like stroke. We have seen acute kidney injuries, acute renal failure. We have seen patients coming with acute coronary syndrome. So also these are the other clinical varied presentation which can happen. Also two very, very important clinical features which come is loss of taste and loss of smell. I think this is one very important clinical, again, GI manifestation which can present as COVID-19. Very important to know is that today, suppose if I get fever, then the issue comes is that how long am I infectious to others? Suppose if I met my friends yesterday for a cup of tea, and today if I develop fever, I am usually infectious 24 to 48 hours before I develop the fever. That means all those people who are with me, close contacts, 24 hours before developing fever is the infection. So I would say it's 24 to 48 hours, but I think practically we will take 24 hours as a close contact. Now, what do you mean by close contact? Close contact means any person who is high risk close contact is one who has come in close contact with a person, both of them not wearing a surgical mask or an N95 mask or whatever the reason be. And if they are together for more than 15 minutes and less than 1 meter distance. So it is less than 1 meter distance, more than 15 minutes, and provided both the persons not wearing masks. I think now in the present time, I think everybody wears a mask. So the level of exposure as of now, I would say it will be a mild or moderate risk contact, but usually high risk contact will be very, very unlikely, and high risk contact will happen only in hostel or when you're staying in your home where you mingle with your family, that will be high risk contact in case if I develop fever. So that way. So a person who develop fever usually will be more infectious at home because there usually nobody will be wearing mask, or if the person is staying in the hostel with the roommates, this very, very commonly happens with the nursing staff where they stay in a common hostel, where they stay in one room, 10 people, or sometimes it may be a big hall with a lot of staff nurses staying together. So this is very important as close contact. Another area of close contact is that if you're in the same room for more than 2 hours and if the distance is less than 2 meters, that is also called as close contact. So this prodromal symptom, there is fever, cough, GI complaint, usually will last for 1 to 7 days. And these are the milder symptoms, and usually the treatment, possibly here, I would just possibly give symptomatic treatment or only a hydroxychloroquine. So what happens to, suppose if the 100 people develop these symptoms, 85% of them usually will clear the virus, or 85% would recover completely, and this is called as mild illness. The rest 15% will go forward to develop a moderate to severe illness, and the fever will be persistent, they will be still lethargic, X-ray will show some features of bilateral groundless haziness, and their patient may also have a small patch of pneumonia. So stage one prodromal is called as stage one. Pneumonia stage is divided into two stages. 2A, where the person has the developing X-ray features of pneumonia or bilateral haziness, but not hypoxic. Stage 2B is where the patient has X-ray infiltrate and is also having hypoxia. And this is called as happy. There are some majority of the patients in COVID-19 also will have happy hypoxia. That means the patient will be mildly tachypneic, but he will not be aware that he's hypoxic. And that is what happens. Majority of the patients who land up in the ICU, intensive care unit, will be having a very, very low saturation, and they usually look very comfortable. This is called as happy hypoxia. Again, I repeat, prodromal stage is stage 1. Pneumonia is divided into two stages. Stage 2A, where the X-ray is showing features of pneumonia or bilateral haziness, and patient is not hypoxic. Stage 2B is where the X-ray is showing haziness and the patient is hypoxic. Why it is important to differentiate this stage 1, stage 2A, 2B? Because in 2A, what I would do is possibly along with hydroxychloroquine, I would add lopinavir ritonavir. In fact, your antiviral should come in the first week only rather than in the second week. But yes, the recommendation is to give in the, you know, after 5 to 7 days. Possibly I would add azithromycin also in this 2A stage. 2B stage is inflammatory stage. So stage 1 is only a prodromal phase. Stage 2, that is pneumonia 2A and 2B, is an inflammatory stage. Okay, so that means it's the inflammatory stage, and possibly some role of steroids come into the picture here when the patient starts getting hypoxic. As of 15% of the people who would go into this 2A, 2B stage, some of them, 5% of these 15%, will progress to a multi-organ failure shock, or who will develop a cytokine storm and will be in the intensive care unit, requiring high dose of oxygen, will be on ventilator, may be requiring inotropic support and all that. So this immunological phase, or the cytokine phase, is the phase where you require to add possibly further anti-inflammatory drugs like tocilizumab, which is an interleukin-6 inhibitor, or you may require convalescent plasma and all that. I think as my slide keeps going, I will talk about this. So this one slide itself tells you completely how the clinical patient would behave and what are the various lines of treatment this patient should be receiving. So the next slide, I think Dr. Anupa has already shown you this. The viral phase is only in the beginning, which is peak in the to begin with. And over a period of 10 days, the viral load keeps going down, and then the patient's immune response comes. And if there's a hyperimmune response, then these are the people who go into cytokine storm, and this is usually seen in after 7 to 8 days of the illness, not in the beginning. Yeah, so the next slide tells you that how long the person would be contagious. So here patients are asymptomatic, okay, there are no symptoms but tested positive. Who are the people who will have no symptom but tested positive? Usually if one household member is positive, the rest of the three people are called as close contact, because maximum close contacts are usually in the household, people at home or in the hospital. And all those people who are in close contact, if you test them, even if they don't have symptoms, they may test positive. I'm not saying everybody would test positive, but in case that person has got no symptoms, okay, but test positive, is called an asymptomatic close contact. And usually they are infectious up to almost to the tune of 14 days. Okay, so that's why the government says that you have to be quarantined close contact up to 14 days. That's the rationale behind it. Then people who have mild to moderate symptoms are usually contagious almost up to the 14 to 21 days. And patients who have severe symptoms, that is who develop pneumonia, hypoxia, landing up in the ICU, they may be contagious almost to 21 to 28 days. And those people who have critical symptoms, who are into ARDS, multi-organ failure, shock, they will also be contagious to the tune of 28 days. But very important, this factor, asymptomatic close contacts, it has to be quarantined for 14 days at home to prevent spreading it in the community. So this is very important. And very important is that usually you see that majority of people who behave badly are the people who are above 55 to 60 years of age. If you see that majority of people who are at risk of developing severe COVID-19 illness is usually the people above 75 to 80. I would say in India, we are seeing more and more people more than 55 years of age that they are developing severe symptoms. I think, and that's why this is the Western data where we are seeing more of people above 70 years of age, but in India, we are seeing that even above 50 and 55 also we see severe illness. But a younger generation, we do not see much problem, and children are almost to the tune of 0%. They are full recovery in this. So milder people who are less than 40 years of age will have very mild illness, but above 45 to 50 may develop moderate or moderate to severe illness in around 15% of the patients. Not everybody, around 15% of the patients. So that's very important. Coming to my next slide, if you see the criticality of the lockdown, this is a slide which was much later. I've just included that. If we wouldn't have done this, what India has done a beautiful job is they have done a nationwide lockdown. And this by 15 April, we saw so many cases. By now, we have almost 50,000 cases. But if by 15 April itself, if there was no lockdown, we would have seen 8.2 lakh cases. So that is the impact what the lockdown has done to reduce the number of cases. And even today by 7th May, we just have above 50,000 cases. Otherwise, this would have been to the tune of, I do not know, maybe 50 lakhs possibly, if the lockdown wouldn't happen. If you see worldwide, the India's strictest quick response, India has been done 100% job in doing the lockdown and trying to flatten the curve. I'm not saying it will be able to eradicate, but it's known to flatten the curve. Who should be tested? I think Dr. Anupa has already taken this, so I'll not go into this. She has already given you the ICMR guidelines who should be tested about this. Now, how to approach a patient? I think I'll skip this slide. We'll try to take questions. I think this slide also, Dr. Anupa has nicely mentioned that initially it's the RT-PCR only which is coming positive, and your IgM will start coming positive only after day 7 and peaks at day 14 and remains positive till day 21, and your IgG will start coming only positive after day 14. So your test in an acute setting is to do only RT-PCR, as she has very clearly mentioned on that, and IgG, IgM antibody is not a test to begin with, and which is also not available. I think this slide is also very clearly elaborated that RT-PCR is the one which is only 60 to 70% where it will come positive. And this is a slide which shows that by day 14, if somebody has developed COVID-19 proven, then by day 14, IgM will be positive in almost 100% of the people. Now coming to the simple, so what are the blood tests you would like to do a patient who comes to you in the emergency room? I think I will do a CBC because CBC is very, very important test in the era of COVID. The next two slides will tell you how important CBC is. Apart from that, I will do a C-reactive protein. When the C-reactive protein is more than 100, it tells you that the severity, it is a severe disease. I will do an LDH, I will do an SGPT, I will do an X-ray chest. These are the basic tests which I will do. But in a tertiary care center, if the patient is hypoxic, I will do interleukin 6, I will do ferritin, I will do D-dimer, I will do LDH, I will do possibly a CT scan also. Now let's come to the CBC, how it is important. If you see this slide, a new prognostic indicator, neutrophil lymphocyte ratio. So if your patient is more than age of 50 and if the neutrophil to lymphocyte ratio is 3.13, more than 3.13, that means suppose if you have a CBC which is showing 92% neutrophil and only 8% lymphocytes. Normal lymphocyte count is around 20%. So if your lymphocyte count is very low, lymphopenia, that means your patient is most likely maybe COVID. Okay, even in bacterial infection you will have, but in bacterial infection your WBC counts will be high. Here your WBC counts are normal or on the lower side and they have lymphopenia. They have a low lymphocyte rate. So if your neutrophil to lymphocyte ratio is more than 3.13, if the age is more than 50, these are the patients who usually will land up in the ICU. If your age is more than 50 and the neutrophil lymphocyte ratio is more than 3.1, is less than 3.13, then these patients require to be still, you know, observed in the hospital where they have ICU facility. But if your age is less than 50 and if your neutrophil lymphocyte ratio is less than 3.13, patient can be, most likely they have milder illness and they can be asymptomatic or mild illness and can be observed in the COVID care centers, isolated, or at home also they can be monitored. So this is the importance of the neutrophil lymphocyte ratio. Another slide which tells you that if your patient is ill here, and by day 15, okay, if your lymphocytes do not recover, then the patient has a bad outcome and the mortality will be high. But if the initial lymphocyte count was low, and suppose the lymphocyte count is coming to less than 20%, these patients do usually do well. And by day 10, day 14, if your lymphocyte count is improved to more than 20%, usually majority of the patients would clinically improve. And this is the importance of a simple CBC, which will tell you about the neutrophil lymphocyte ratio and how lymphocytes, how bad the, if the severe lymphopenia, how they would behave badly. Who should receive prophylaxis? I think prophylaxis should be received for all household close contacts. I already defined you what is close contacts. All people who are working in COVID ICU, COVID ward, or people who are working in emergency room should be receiving hydroxychloroquine prophylaxis. Those people who are close contact at home will require 400 PD for day one, and then 400 every weekly once for 3 weeks. But people who are working in the intensive care unit, COVID ward, COVID ICU, or working in the emergency room, or even dialysis centers, possibly I would add, they will require 400 BD on day one, and then they will require 400 weekly for 7 weeks. I do not know whether they will have to extend this further or not, but as of now, that's the guideline, and this is what is required. So coming to the treatment part, I think I already mentioned you about the treatment that in mild to moderate cases, possibly I would give as it hydroxychloroquine 400 milligram twice a day on day one, and followed by 200 milligram twice a day for day 5 to day 10. And if it's mild disease, then I would just give hydroxychloroquine. It's moderate. Moderate means people who have comorbid condition, then possibly I would add azithromycin. And if the patient is slightly hypoxic, I may add lopinavir, ritonavir also. I will come to the what is the significance of lopinavir. If the patient has got severe disease, that is moderate to severe or severe disease, who are hypoxic, then I would add possibly hydroxychloroquine plus azithromycin plus lopinavir, ritonavir to these patients. So all the three drugs I would add, and maybe there is some role of ivermectin. I'm not sure how good it is, but in clinical trials it is shown that it in vitro it inhibits the viral replication, and it's a simple drug. So all these drugs are, there is no definitive antiviral drug as such, but these are all supportive line of treatment what we will be giving to the patient. So coming to the critical disease, those people, I think I'll come to my subsequent slides will tell you how do we do deal with the critical disease. So this was a trial, which is a very small number of trial, which was done about people who are given placebo, neither given azithromycin, neither hydroxychloroquine, the viral load remained high. Those people who are given hydroxychloroquine only, that by day 6, the viral load came down. But those people who received hydroxychloroquine with azithromycin, their viral load was negligible on day 5, but the number of people were very small. But they did not measure in the control group if not given what would happen. But subsequently, today's NEJM report has come that hydroxychloroquine, there was no much benefit. So there is conflicting report, whereas one Chinese report says that yes, it is beneficial and reduces the mortality by 82%. So there have been conflicting reports. We'll have to wait from India, the trial which is going on, to see what exactly happens. So this is a trial which was done for, again, conflicting report, where hydroxychloroquine was given to 1,061 patients, and it showed that 91% protection. But it did not show if you wouldn't have given another group 1,061 patients, not given hydroxychloroquine or azithromycin, what would have happened to those patients. So there was no control arm. So we cannot take full, because 91% of patients got better, but 85% anyway might have mild disease and they would have got better otherwise also. So this is very difficult to contemplate unless you have a control arm in this. Now coming to the lopinavir, ritonavir, this was a paper which came in New England Journal of Medicine. We described that whether you give lopinavir, ritonavir or not give lopinavir, there was not much of clinical benefit with this antiviral drug. But in India, this is the only antiviral as of now which is available. And so with whatever benefit we should be using, we are using in this in moderate to severe patient. But this trial, there was a criticism that all these people received lopinavir, ritonavir only after 10 to 13 days of the illness. Actually, antiviral drug should be given early and not when the inflammation or the cytokine storm starts. So there is a criticism, and so we do not know. Lopinavir, ritonavir still may be useful. As of now in India, we would use it. Coming to the new drug, which is remdesivir, which is used in Europe and USA, seems to be quite promising, and it showed that people who were not given the drug, okay, compared to people who were given the drug, there was a definite benefit, and especially benefit for people less than 50 years of age compared to people more than 70 years of age. But again, the new latest report again showed that remdesivir also was possibly not very useful. But again, the problem was that they gave only after day 10 of illness. I think all these antivirals should be given when the virus is active. Just like when you have an H1N1, you take the Tamiflu immediately. It works beautifully. It will not work if you give it after 5 to 7 days. So similarly, when you have an antiviral, I would say if you have a, if tomorrow we come up with a proper, perfect antiviral, I would be happy to initiate that antiviral immediately and not later on, because you have to give it when the viral activity is more. This is a new drug which we are most likely to going to be getting it in India, that is Favipiravir, and I think Global Hospital Mumbai maybe it may be one of the centers for trying this Favipiravir, and it is supposed to be promising, but as of now we do not have a drug just like oseltamivir for H1N1. We don't have a, that type of a drug for COVID-19 as of now. So let's hope that Favipiravir, which will be available maybe after 4 to 6 weeks in India, is going into clinical trials in shortly within a 7 days time. This is again a promising drug which is used in Japan and China. Now coming to the next slide about infectious disease, I think I'll skip this because I was not. So are there any patients who go into ARDS, multi-organ failure or cytokine syndrome, anything? You know, these people who have bilateral haziness, x-rays looking bad, bilateral pneumonias, and these are the x-rays which show extensive involvement. Is there anything more than the antiviral drug, hydroxychloroquine or azithromycin we can do? Yes, there is steroid. As I said, 2A, 2B is inflammatory stage. You should use steroids possibly. This is individualized. This is not a recommendation. This is individualized clinical judgment that usually if you have to use it in 2A, 2B, not in stage 1 or stage 3. If you use in stage 1, the infection viral load may go high. If you use in stage 3, patient may develop more infection. So there is some role of steroid, but it has to be a clinical judgment and individualized. It is not a recommendation. The other thing is this trial of dexamethasone showed that there was definitely a benefit in people who are used dexamethasone compared to the control. But again, this is individualized. Coming to my next slide, which talks about high dose of immunoglobulin. Again, this is a small trial which has been used in very few patients where we do not know whether it is going to be useful or not. Convalescent plasma, you must have been reading a lot of newspapers. Convalescent seems to be promising, has been used extensively in USA. And we are going to be, you know, possibly we would like to wait for more results to see about convalescent plasma in severe COVID patients. I would say we should use in moderate or moderate to severe, not when the patient is lands up in ICU and cytokine. We should use it early to have a good clinical benefit. This is about tocilizumab, what I was talking about, the interleukin-6 inhibitors to be used when the patient is going into hypoxia with 2B stage and also patients who are going to severe stage. I think again tocilizumab, we should be using all this in the 2B stage when the patient is getting hypoxic. So that's all about the various treatments. So we have hydroxychloroquine, azithromycin, the three antivirals, that is lopinavir, ritonavir, remdesivir, and we have the favipiravir, which is going to be launched in India. And then we have gamma globulin, convalescent plasmas, and then we have steroids and tocilizumab. So the summary is, truth is, no definitive antiviral drug available just now, all supportive or no, or immunomodulators. Either we require an effective vaccine or a definitive antiviral for COVID-19. HCQA is only to high-risk contacts or healthcare working in ER, COVID-19 wards or ICU. Hydroxychloroquine, azithromycin for mild to moderate cases. And lopinavir, ritonavir for severe cases. Remdesivir being used in USA. Corticosteroids, convalescent plasma, gamma globulin, tocilizumab. No recommendation. It is a trial basis. There's no strong recommendation for this. Also, one more point I wanted to tell you is any patient in the present illness developing pneumonia who comes to you with severe acute respiratory illness, even if the two COVIDs are negative, until and unless proven, this has to be considered as COVID-19, because we had patients who are intubated to nasopharyngeal swab negative, and when we sent the endotracheal aspirate which showed positive COVID-19, and I think Dr. Anupama clearly showed that when you send a respiratory lower respiratory tract secretion, that is the endotracheal secretions, if the chance of positivity is 93% compared to the nasopharyngeal swab, which is only 70%. So in the present era, all patients who come to you with severe respiratory insufficiency, until and unless proven, it has to be considered as COVID-19. Thank you for your kind attention. I'll be happy to take questions.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the lovely and informative presentation. We will now move on to the Q&A session. But before that, we will be now collecting the details of the attendees for the certificate. If the attendees look at the top of the chat box, you will notice that a link has been posted in the sticky message. Please click this link and enter your details exactly how you want it in the certificate. Let me repeat, only those who attendees who have filled in the form will be provided the certificate. Once you enter these details and submitted the form, you will receive a certificate of attendance in your email inbox within 7 working days. You can also see a poll has been uploaded. Please rate us according to the quality of this of the material in this webinar with 1 to 10, with 10 being the best. Let's now move on to the Q&A. There are a lot of questions which have been posted for both doctors. I'll start off with Dr. Vasant. Yes. For the attention of the attendees, I'll be asking these questions on the basis of how many questions have been asked the most. So one of the most popular questions is the role of anticoagulants, given the hypercoagulable state that is seen in COVID-19.
Yeah, so I think there are two types. I do not go into the critical care management of the patients. Yes, there are two types of presentation of the virus, the L type and the H type. L type is there, the type of virus where your X-rays would look normal and they are usually hypoxic. Okay, so then you'll be wondering why this is happening. And this is usually the L type where the lungs are usually compliant and you really don't require difficult to ventilation. The problem is the oxygenation, but the lungs are, you know, quite palatable and, you know, you don't really require high beep, unlike the H1N1, where you have difficult to ventilate these people in ARDS. So there are two reasons. One is the inflammatory, and as correctly this question has been asked very nicely, it is also a thromboembolic disease, and we do use for milder cases at least 40 milligram or 40 to 60 milligram of low molecular heparin. And when we have a very clear indication, the X-ray CT look quite okay, patient is hypoxic, COVID-19 positive, possibly we may go up to 40 BD and 60 BD also, apart from the other line of treatment, that is hydroxychloroquine, azithromycin, plus minus steroids or whatever. Yes, we do use anticoagulation, and that is one of the parts of the treatment.
Thank you, sir. A question for Dr. Anupa. One question that has been asked quite often is, what labs can actually do the testing? What are the criteria labs should be that fulfilled so that they can get the permission from the government to start testing for COVID-19?
Okay. Thank you for this question, Dr. Vineet. But a part of it I have covered in the presentation, which talks about for RT-PCR tests, we need to have an ICMR permission. And how do we get the ICMR permission is for the lab which has NABL certificate for RNA testing currently. Those are the one which can apply, and those which fulfill other criteria can apply. And once the permission is granted by ICMR, we can go ahead with the testing for RT-PCR. And clearly mentioned, antibody testing is still restricted and it's not given to the private laboratories as such till now.
Another question about sample collection that has been asked multiple times is, nasopharyngeal and throat swabs are taken together.
Right.
Some people have a question, are they analyzed together or separately? If separately, so which one? And the second question is, when collected, should they be transported in different VTM mediums or in the same medium?
So what we have done is we have followed the ICMR guidelines, and ICMR has very clearly laid the guidelines which talk about having two swabs collected both from the nasopharyngeal and the oropharynx, and it goes in one VTM. So having a proper collection protocol, and they have actually defined how to collect the sample. That's extremely, extremely crucial. And it goes in the same VTM, gets transported as per the desired transportation criteria. And very important is the packaging aspect to it. There has to be a triple layer packaging so that we don't expose others to the infection. So once both the swabs, oropharyngeal and nasopharyngeal, goes in the single VTM transport media, gets transported well, comes to the lab for processing, that's the way ICMR is looking at it. And that's the way we follow.
Thank you, Dr. Anupa. Dr. Vasant, another question that's been quite often asked is about reinfection. Can a patient who is recovered from this be reinfected? And another question that's also combined with this been asked is that many doctors are getting infected despite wearing PPE. So can you elaborate on the infection portion of this?
So I think the first part of the question is whether it's a reinfection. I think it was made very clear that whatever reinfections were reported, actually they were not really reinfections. So we do not know much about this. But yes, I would say that all those people who again develop symptoms could have been because of some other viral illnesses, but the RT-PCR came positive. So once you have an RT-PCR which is coming positive after day 10, day 14, sometimes it comes up to day 28, day 57, I don't think they are just the tests which come positive, but there will be no infectiousness. So it may be a viral small contingent particle which is giving the positive report, but there will be no true viral load which will give a positive report as such. So that is the first part of the question. So I don't think there is reinfection, but only time will tell us, and the reports which were reported initially as reinfection were not reinfection at all. The second part of that, in spite of wearing full PPE, how can a person still get infected? One is, if you're not doing your donning. Donning is when you wear the PPE, that is not a problem. When you're doffing, that is when you're removing your PPE, that is a major concern. Yes, because you may not be doing the doffing properly, because this is the time when you can get infected. You should not be touching the outside portion of your gown. You should not be removing your mask and goggles first. There has to be a stepwise process what you should be doing. That is part one. And also, you may be, while in the ICU, you may be touching your nose, face, all that issues are there. And another thing is that possibly you may be getting it from the community or friends when you are not in the ICU. You are in the ICU for 6-8 hours. After that, you are out in the hostel community with the friends or traveling. So it's possible that you might get the infection from the community also. As you see, that there's a lot of community spread now. They are already there into the system. So these are the possibilities how you can get the infection in spite of wearing a full PPE.
Thank you for the answer, Dr. Vasanth. We are also getting quite a lot of questions, so I'll club these together. There are quite a lot of people very interested in knowing the role of certain drugs in COVID-19. So there are many questions on the role of steroids, on the role of ACE inhibitors, and about HCQS, about how good is HCQS when it comes to prophylaxis.
So there is no world-time data about HCQS prophylaxis, but ICMR has given the guidelines, and possibly it is more of a immunomodulator and inflammatory. Only time will tell us how good it has been as a prophylaxis. That's the part of the first question. Second, I think steroids are very clearly elaborated that it has no role in stage 1 and stage 3. It has got a clear-cut role, possibly in stage 2B, but it is not a recommendation. It is a individual clinical judgment. Every patient has to be judged clinically, and also to see that the patient has COVID-19, high suspect of COVID-19 positive. Not that every patient who comes to the ER will be COVID-19. So you have to take a clinical judgment. There is a small role about steroid in these people, apart from this tocilizumab, convalescent plasma, and all the other treatments.
Okay, thank you, Doctor Anupa. Another question that's been asked quite often is for you to elaborate on pool testing. What exactly is pool testing, and can that help us in the scenario?
So that's a very interesting concept. So again, I'll refer back to ICMR, who has released an advisory talking about the pool testing as an option. Now, in this advisory, they have actually mentioned how to perform the test, which includes the protocol which need to be followed in brief, and also the number is not more than 5 samples. Now, it's a very research-oriented topic, and it needs elaborate study and validation protocol, which a lab needs to establish for itself first before we actually start releasing reports by a pool sample. It's a very good, interesting concept. Although there are multiple publications which I've read, they talk about doing pooling for 10 samples, 18 samples, 20 samples. But I think here ICMR is making a very correct point. They have recommended 5 samples at the max for pooling. And again, coming back to the lab, every lab who thinks about pooling has to establish this test with correct sensitivity and specificity. So it's a very interesting concept, and we are already trying to pool samples and see how the results are coming. So we are moving ahead in this direction. Let's see how it takes the shape going ahead.
Thank you, Dr. Anupa. Dr. Vasanth, another question that's being asked is about the role of plasma therapy. Is it feasible, and how effective is it?
So it has been found to be effective in a lot of US trials, and I think in India also ICMR has giving some of the hospitals to do this study. It is effective if you do it in the moderate, before the patient really become very, very severe. So I think it should be timed properly, moderate to severe. But again, it is not a recommendation. It is an individual clinical judgment to individual patients who would benefit or not. I think you'll have to do interleukin 6 levels, you'll have to do ferritin, you'll have to do D-dimer. Your D-dimer has to be more than 1,000. Your ferritin has to be more than 300. Your LDH has to be more than 250. Your interleukin 6 has to be more than at least 100 to 150. So all these criteria should be fitted, and the patient not getting better with the first line of treatment, that is whether steroid plus minus or not. And I think that would be possibly an indication, but it has to be individualized, not a recommendation as far as by any. In fact, the sepsis guidelines said it is not a recommendation. It should be on a trial basis and individualized. Also, very important is, I think all those people who are severe, we recommend even people who are mild hypoxia to have a prone. You know, we make them sleep prone, and that really improves their oxygenation. Also, people who are ventilated, also we make them prone if their oxygenation is not improved. I think prone, awake prone is another modality to improve their oxygenation.
Thank you, sir. One other question that's been asked, I think either speaker can answer this, is about herd immunity. Where can herd immunity help us in stopping COVID-19 transmission?
I think finally, either the vaccine which comes into the picture or the herd immunity. I think these are the only two ways where, because the virus is there to stay here, it's not going to go in next 2 weeks or 4 weeks, it's there to stay for possibly a longer time. And I think once you develop 60 to 70% of the people gets infected with this COVID virus, or if people are vaccinated, only then you'll develop the herd immunity.
Okay, we are running out of time, so I'll stop with this one last question. We had a last question for Dr. Vasant about the interpretation of the neutrophil lymphocyte ratio. One person has asked about how do you do that in a pediatric age group? How do you interpret the NLR in a pediatric age group?
So, interesting question, and I really don't have an answer, but I think all people who develop, even in pediatrics, okay, those who develop severe viral infection will always, otherwise they always have a lymphocyte count which is in the higher sex likely. But those people who develop severe viral infection or COVID-19, by day 3, day 4, possibly you will start seeing lymphopenia. But I do not have a, since I'm not looking to pediatrics, I don't have an answer. But I think maybe I'll check with my pediatrician, an interesting question, which also for me to think back.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you to both speakers for phenomenal presentations today. I would also like to thank all the attendees for joining us today and for their very interesting questions. Please note, we will email you a link to the recording of this webinar within 24 to 48 hours. You will be able to watch the webinar in its entirety at your convenience. Please feel free to forward the link of the recording to your colleagues who may have missed this today's sessions. Thank you once again. Thank you to everyone. Goodbye and good night. Stay safe.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Rupama. Thank you. Thank you, Sanjay.